Okay, good morning, everyone. Good to see you this morning. Good to have you with us today. If you would, let's all stand. Turn to page 276, please. 276. We'll sing the first and last verse. And good to see you all. Good to see you all online this morning. And hope you had a good week and pray for your week ahead. Page 276. Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without him I would fall. When I am sad, to him I go. No other one can cheer me so. When I am sad, he makes me glad. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me. I want no better friend. I trust him now. I'll trust him when life's fleeting day shall end. Beautiful life with such a friend. Beautiful life that has no end. Eternal life, eternal joy. He's my friend. Amen.
All right. Good morning, everyone. We're glad that you're with us. Ones in the home, we're glad you tuned in. Also, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you that we can approach your throne once again. And Lord, we're needy people, and we rely upon you and look to you for the blessing of today and to healing the body. And Lord, we just pray that your will be done today, and give us a great day throughout this day, Lord, and may you glorify you. We might worship you today in truth and spirit, Lord. And I just ask you to bless the ones that are with us today, for we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated. Gentlemen, if you'll come, we'll take our offering at this time. See you're ready to go, and so we'll do that now. Please pray for the offerings, if you will. That the Lord's will be done, keeping the lights on and the heat on and things of that nature. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Cross, lead us, please, sir. Please remember to pray for the ones that we have been mentioning, and we'll continue to do so. And until we see improvement made by individuals that we call their name. And of course, we do that on purpose to keep you mindful as the days go by. You know, we get busy and we forget about a lot of things that have to do with our church and get involved in our own lives and things like that. But we certainly should not forget to pray for the ones that are under the weather, that are sick and have been for some time. And we just continue praying for them, the ones that we know of. And, you know, there are some said, well, you didn't pray for me. And, well, if you don't make it known, we'll not be doing that because we just don't know. Okay, so Juanita Gosser, pray for her. And Leonard, if you will, just pray for both of them that the Lord's will be done. And, of course, she is recuperating in hospice. And so, and of course, Leonard is alone. Rehab, okay. Rehab, and so they're at Aspen, only in a different building, and so I pray for them, if you will. And then also Mary Doble. I think she was supposed to gone home. I don't know whether she did or not. Pardon me?
She did.
She went home, okay. I knew that they were talking about that, but I hadn't heard. And so she's home, and I'm sure that she'll be recuperating a lot sooner of being at home and things of that nature. So just continue to pray for her and Tony as well, that the Lord's will be done. And then Marcia Merrick, she's going to be having an injection on the 21st. And so that's the schedule anyway. And so pray for her, continue back problems and leg problems and different things like that, and pray for Tom as well. And again, pray for Henry, and then pray for Cindy as well. We want you to pray for that. And then Pat Hewlett, pray for her, and then pray for Kenny, changing the medicine. And so I need to pray for him. That the Lord's will be done. Blair Dawson, pray for her on the knee surgery 20th?
Yeah, the 20th.
20th, okay. Pardon me?
Week from Monday, yes.
Week from Monday, okay, on the 20th. And so pray for her. And then understand that Bruce Turner had surgery on his hand and back. And so pray for him as well. And then, as always, pray for our church, praying for one another, that the Lord's will be done in the life and of our church, and pray for the pastor, and pray for the leadership of our church, and that the Lord's will be done there. Pray for our country, president, leadership of our country, just because sometimes God doesn't work when we want Him to, and but I'm sure that He is, and so I believe that that the Lord is working in the hearts and lives of the president and the leadership of our country, and then for the state of Indiana, pray for the state and the governor, lieutenant governor, and the leadership of our state, as well as our country. The policemen, pray for them. You know, we have some good cops and bad cops, or policemen. I don't like to call them cops, but policemen. We have some good and some bad. And so just pray for them, that the ones that are not doing their job will be dismissed and others taking their place. Although I would not volunteer to be a policeman. No way in the world would I want to do that, and that's a very difficult job, very strenuous, and always under a lot of criticism, pressures, and things like that. So pray for the policemen, the first responders, and also for the military. Pray for them that the Lord's will be done. And then Brother Bevan of Mexico had a letter from him Wednesday night, and you have a letter from the Lindsays today in your bulletin. So pray for them, if you will. Do we have anyone in this section new prayer request? Anyone at all? How about in the middle section? Yes, Becky. Okay.
And so they sent me a message asking if we would put Jill, is her first name, on our prayer list.
Evan and Michelle?
It's Evan and Sheree's aunt.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay.
Her name is Jill, and she has breast
cancer. Okay. Pray for that, if you will. Okay. And anybody else? Far section, anyone? Anyone unspoken? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you that we can approach your throne. And Lord, once again, we just get discouraged in seeing the progress that's being made by different ones that are sick. And Lord, I just pray that you would help us in our faith to grow stronger towards them. And Lord, that you would work in their hearts and lives, and Father, raise them up, and Lord, encourage them and strengthen them, and especially being with them spiritually, they'd grow in faith. And Lord, I just pray that your will be done, for we do ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Brother Gray.
Okay, if you would, take your hymnals and turn to page 538, please. Page number 538, we'll sing the first and the second verse of 538. Blessed be the name, the first and second verse. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave his son for man to die, that he might man redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name above all names shall stand, exalted more and more. At God the Father's own right hand, where angel hosts adore. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen.
Good day, Cindy. Thank you. Turn your Bible, if you will, to John chapter 6. John chapter 6, and we'll continue in our study of the book of John. I don't know whether outline would help you in knowing where we're heading. Sometimes that does help individuals if they have an idea of where we're going. And so just very quickly, I believe that we'll be covering at least verse 14 all the way down to verse 22, I believe, or 21, somewhere around there today. And so I believe I will just give you a quick outline that one that I made up. It's not official or anything like that. But we see, first of all, you are going to be seeing the response of the people to the miracle of the loaves and fishes. And you'll see that as we start out in verse 14 and 15. You'll see that taking place. And, of course, we see that also in verse 15, where you'll see the Lord departing to the mountain. And, of course, there is a word there at the end. And I was looking at that word, why it says, into a mountain himself alone. Alone. I thought that was a little strange to just put on alone. And I got to looking at it, and I got to thinking about it, and I went into a little bit of it. And so we'll be looking at that as well. And of course, we see that not only that, but we finally see the disciples going down to the sea. And of course, they're in they're in the midst of the storm there, as we look in verse 16 through 19 thereabouts. So we'll be looking at that, and then of course we see that in verse 20 through 21, the coming Lord coming to the disciples, and of course we see and we'll just go on down. We'll see also the people following the Lord. In verse 22 through 25, you'll see that. And then, of course, the Lord revealing the spiritual need to the people in verse 27. And so going all the way down to verse 27, it covers what I believe is a section that is be completed. And a thought there that comes about. And so we see that, and of course, the Lord has revealed his divine power. If you go back and in the first part of chapter 6, he has revealed his power to the people. And then not only that, we see the crowd was impressed by what the Lord had done. And, of course, we see the effect of it as we go into looking at verse 14, the effect that it had upon the people. It really impressed the people that what the Lord did then, the miracle. And look at verse 14 where we'll start reading. Then those men, when they had seen the miracle that Jesus did, said, this is a truth that prophet that should come unto the world. Now, first of all, we see the impression that it had upon the men, and the Bible says that it had a truth there about, is this the one? You'll remember going back into chapter 1 in the book of John, where that the Jewish people asked John the Baptist, are you that prophet? And I think in verse 21 or somewhere around there in chapter 1, you'll see that. Are you Elias or are you that prophet? And of course, John said, no, I'm not. I'm not that prophet. And so we see it again when we see that it says, this is of a truth. In other words, they said, we are convinced that this is the prophet. This is the one that we've been looking for all along. And, of course, I believe, I think that we dealt with that in chapter 1 where we saw that in Deuteronomy. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, where all of the Jewish people back then in the Old Testament time was looking forward to that prophet. That's all they could think about was that prophet. And, of course, that prophet would be none other than the Messiah that would come into the world. And, of course, they were thinking that Jesus was the Messiah, which he is. He's the Messiah. But we find here that as they looked at that, at the prophet, that prophet, and of course we see the effect that it had upon that, that it does say in verse 15, and when Jesus therefore perceived that they would come and make him, take him by force to make him a king, he departed again into the mountain himself alone. And so here we see that the Lord knew what they were going to do. They were going to make him a king. Well, go back and just think about that for a minute. You don't make Jesus a king. You don't make him a king. If you look in the book of Matthew, what is it, chapter 2 or 3, where shepherds came and said, where is he that is born king of the Jews? And so we see that Jesus was born to be king. They don't make him king. He is already king. Just like people will say something like this, we make Jesus our Savior. No, he's already the Savior. We don't make him anything. He is already. And so here we find that they wanted to make him a king. And of course, they had no idea of what was involved in it. If they would have read the scriptures, and I believe that we have gone over this quite a few times, that these people did not believe in the scriptures. They simply did not believe in the scriptures. They had their own, what they called the Talmud, and they had replaced that with the Word of God. And of course, I had seen that, and I believe that you probably remember that when I mentioned it to you. And so they totally did not believe in the Word of God. And so they would dismiss all the things about it. But, you know, if you would go, and we cannot do that, but if you would go into the book of Matthew, and you would look, you would read the whole book of Matthew, you would find out what would be the requirement that the people had in order to bring about Messiah or have the king, and of course, Matthew is about the king and about the kingdom. And so they would have found out what would be involved in having him be king over them. And of course, they were taking the shortcut. Do you remember Matthew chapter 4, where that devil taking Jesus up on the mountain? And of course, it showed him all the kingdoms of the world and things like that. And all them, the impressive things, the devil said, if you will worship me, I'll give you all the kingdoms of this world. And of course, we know Jesus refused that, but we see that he already has all the kingdoms of the world. Eventually, he will be king of this world. He'll be king over all of the world. And so we see that that was just another ploy of the devil of trying to convince the Lord to take a shortcut to the cross, to becoming king of the earth. But you know, the one thing that they missed out on totally and completely was this. They did not realize that he was king and he was a prophet and he was a priest. And so we see the three offices of the Lord Jesus Christ, being prophet, being a king, and being a priest. Or you could say being a prophet, a priest, and a king. And so there's the three offices. But here they're trying to make him to become king without being fulfilling his priestly duties or responsibilities. Do you forget about the responsibility that Jesus Christ has as priest. And so they wanted to take a shortcut and make him king and do it without the without the priestly ministry of the Lord. Why is the priestly ministry important? It's because as high priest, he is going to offer himself as a sacrifice. The high priest always went into the tabernacle, temple, wherever it might be, and he always offered the blood upon the altar. And there we see that it is a type of the blood that's shed by the Lord Jesus Christ. And he is going to fulfill his priestly responsibility by offering himself, the Lamb of God, an offering for this world. And that would be before he would become king. He would not, and that's why that he refused and went away from them and had nothing to do with them. And of course it says, when Jesus therefore perceived that they would come and take him by force to make him a king, he departed again into the mountain himself alone. And of course, I believe the loan there is this, that he was making intercession for the disciples that were going out on the sea. That was part of his priestly office. He was alone, and he is the only one that can do that, a high priest's prayer or intercession. And by the way, you do not find, I quickly read over all the book of John again, and you do not find any praying or anything like that in the book of John. You say, well, what about the 17th chapter? Well, that is when he intercedes. We're looking at the 17th chapter of the book of John, where that he is doing his high priestly responsibility of praying for this world, praying for us. He is making intercession. And I believe that there in the where it says he departed again into a mountain himself alone, he was interceding for them. You know, you think about this, where that Jesus is praying. He's always praying to his Father. Remember that? Always praying to his Father. Well, Jesus said he and his Father are one. And so we see that if he prayed to the Father, he'd be praying to himself in the book of John. And so we see that he is God himself. And so, you know, there we see, I didn't study it out all the way, but I believe that has connection with the high priest, of him interceding for the disciples there. And so we see that the Bible telling us very quickly there that he went by himself. And then it says in verse 16, and it is connected along with verse 15, and when evening was now come, his disciples went down unto the sea. And so here we see the Lord going to the mountain, and then we see that the disciples coming to the sea, going to the sea. And of course we see that the Bible says went down to the sea. When we are not in the presence of the Lord, we're always going down. And so we find that the Bible telling us very quickly that they were on their way down. And, of course, being alone by themselves. And then it says in verse 17 that the the Bible tells us there, and entered into a ship and went over the sea towards Capernaum. And it was now dark, and Jesus was not come to them. And so here we find the Bible says it was dark, and Jesus was not with them, went over towards Capernaum, and it was now dark. And of course, we see there the Bible speaks of, over and over again, of darkness. You'll remember in the book of Job, where Job said, I sought light, but darkness came over me. Darkness came over me. And of course, we know the darkness is none other than created by God. God created the darkness, and of course, he created the light as well. You'll see that in Isaiah 45, where you go in into the scriptures, and it says that I created darkness. I created light. And so it's the darkness is not is not created by Satan. It's created by God Almighty. And then if you'd read on or read before whatever, I can't remember, in Isaiah 45, the Lord said there in the Word of God that treasure of darkness. There's a treasure of darkness. There's a reason why God has darkness coming upon individuals, upon his disciples. And sometimes darkness comes upon us. It's a part of God's dealing with the individual. And of course, you know, you spend a lot of time running references on darkness and finding out the treasure of darkness, which I did not do, but you could do it if you're interested in it. But God says that there is treasure in darkness. And, of course, I believe that he is gets the work done on this earth through his individual by creating darkness and then, of course, showing light to the individual that they can do something about it. But then darkness comes sometimes. Let me just ask you this question. Have you ever been in a position where that you did not know what to do? Things happened to you, and you did not know why they were coming upon you. You do not know anything about it. As we say many times, we're in total darkness, and that is true. God brings darkness upon us, and where that we will have to depend more upon him. If God gave us light all the time, we would never depend upon God. We would never stop and begin to pray and ask God for light. Why is this happening? What can I do? And different things like that. If darkness never came upon us, then we would just totally go about our business and do what we want to do and things like that, and we would never think about calling upon God. We would think, well, I can handle that. I can handle it because I know what's taking place and things like that. But when you get in a position where that darkness comes upon you and you do not know what to do, And many times God puts us in that position. And it says there that it says, and entered into a ship and went over the sea towards Capernaum, and it was now dark, and Jesus was not there. And, of course, that gives us a total picture of being in darkness. When the Lord is not present, when the Lord, you think that the heavens are brass, and you can't get through, and the presence of the Lord is not with you, and totally you don't know what to do, and different things like that takes place. And so we see that not only that, but you think about this old world. People that are in the world, they're in darkness, total darkness. They don't know what to do. And, of course, they're without Christ. They have no hope. They have nothing to depend upon or look to. They're in just total darkness. They don't know what to do. And that's when the child of God comes along and reveals light to them. That gives them light. And, of course, we see that the Bible says that light shines out of darkness. And, of course, it's up to us to bring light to a darkened world, a world that is without Christ, that does not know the Lord Jesus Christ. And so here we see that this is a symbol of what the world is and what we sometimes and don't know what to do. But it tells us there that in verse total darkness, being alone and all like that. But we see that in verse 18, where the Bible says, "And the sea arose by reason of a great wind that blew." And so here we see that the disciples were alone. They were in darkness. And then it says, all of a sudden, storms appear. The sea arose a great wind that blew. And so we see the beginning of storms taking place in the life of individuals and to the disciples as well. But notice, if you will, the storm had overtaken them. And of course, I believe the reason for the storm coming up at this particular time was to help them to realize that they are totally dependent upon the Lord. And, of course, this was a test of their faith and patience. What are they going to do when the storms come up? What are we going to do when the storms of life come? Are we going to be overtaken by the storms that come up all of a sudden? Are we going to be looking to our faith? Are we going to be patient and knowing what to do and different things like that when the storms of life just comes up for no reason, just coming up? And of course, I don't think it, of course, most of the disciples that were in the ship, they were fishermen. And so I believe that they knew that the storms was going to come. But did you know, as a child of God, you should know too that the storms of life are going to come upon you as a child of God. You know, many times people believe, have the idea that when you become a Christian, there's no more storms. Everything is going to be smooth sailing. And you just go through life and have, and nothing ever comes up. No controversy or things like that. But storms do come up. And over many people and unprepared for the storms that do come. But I believe that this is a test for the disciples. When storms come in our life, it's a test for us as well, testing our faith. Are we going to stick by the stuff? Are we going to be patient and go through the storm? Or what are we going to do? What are we going to do? The Bible says that these disciples were patient. And as it says in verse 19, so when they had rowed about 5 and 20 or 30 furlongs, they see Jesus walking on the sea and drawing nigh unto the ship, and they were afraid. But notice, if you will, that they had enough faith and patience that they kept on. The Bible says there in verse 19, and when they had rowed, they continued rowing. And it says 5, 20, or 30 furlongs. And so they hadn't give up. They hadn't totally given up and say, well, what's the use? Like a lot of people do today. Maybe you've been one that when storms have come in your life and you said, what's the use? I'll just not depend on the Lord anymore or something like that. I'll quit church or whatever it might be. I'll just give up. I'll quit. We'll never quit. Our faith ought to be enough where that we are going to continue and be patient going through the storms that come up in our life. We ought to be patient because they will come to an end. Eventually, they will come to an end. But the Bible says there that after they continued on, then it says that's when Jesus comes. When you are about ready to give in, then the Lord will make his presence known unto us. And he made his presence known unto the disciples. Well, why were they afraid if they saw him coming? Well, wouldn't you be afraid? For the first time in your life, you saw somebody, a figure, walking upon the water. Wouldn't you be afraid, not knowing who that it was? You know, at that time, that's all Jesus did, was walking upon the water. And they saw the figure, and they had never seen that before. And it was something, it was a supernatural event that took place for the first time in the life of the disciples. They weren't prepared for that. But God, the Lord, was showing himself to be strong and things like that. But then we see that all of a sudden, we see that Jesus speaks, and that made the difference. When he spoke, then the Bible says they willingly, I think it's in verse 21, then they willingly received him into the ship, and immediately the ship was at the land wherein they went, whether they went. And so here we see that Jesus is walking upon the water. We see that not only that, he comes and comes near to them. And then we see that he never will come upon an individual and force himself upon you. The Lord will never do that. They were afraid. And then Jesus says, it is I. And immediately, when they heard the voice, they knew who it was. They knew who it was and what was going to take place. When they heard the voice, you say, well, how can we hear the voice in the day when we pass through the storm? The Word of God. John chapter 1. He is the Word. He was Word. And of course, he's the Word of God. And so he speaks to us through his Word. And when we are in doubt and things like that, and we need the Lord to come, he will speak peace to you through his Word. He will give you encouragement through his Word. He will help you through the Word of God if we will read it at that particular time. And you know, there's so many helps today in which we live. There's verses of scripture that you see that different ones have wrote down for various things, when you're in need. Philippians 4:19, God shall supply all your need, and God speaks to us when we are in need of whatever it might be. God does that through His Word, and so we find here it says, "It is I, be not afraid," and that was so encouraging to the disciples. That was showing them that everything was going to be all right now. And then, of course, they willingly received him into the ship. They willingly received him into the ship. When I read that, immediately my mind went to Revelation chapter 3, where that it says, Jesus said, "I stand at the door and knock. If any man will come unto me, open the door and come unto me, then I will receive him." And so we see that Jesus stands there, and they willingly receive him into the ship. Immediately, the Bible says, and then not only that, but here is something else. It says there, the ship was at the land whither they went. Immediately, halfway through the storm, or the sea, they was going to Capernaum, and commentaries say that they were halfway. But when he comes on board, immediately the storm stops. And they're on the shore. They're at the shore. Now, what does that picture to us tells us? When Jesus comes in, the storms will be over. And immediately, God will give us peace. I was thinking about there that, as it says there, was at land. They had come to rest on the other shore. I was thinking about the haven of rest. Remember the song, "The Haven of Rest"? How that the Lord invites people to the haven of rest. He'll give you rest. And so here we see that the Bible says that they were at land. How they got there? Jesus brought them there. Jesus brought them. The storms were over, and they come to land. They come to the land. Now, isn't that an encouragement to you to know when you go through the storms of life and you let God deal with it and you let the Lord take care of it and be patiently going through, that he comes on, and of course, if we invite him to come in and he willingly do that, invite him in, and then all things have settled down, and where it lands in, it's all over. It's all over. I believe that that's so encouraging. We did not have time to go into verse 22, but I'd like to read that. And it says, "The day following, when the people which stood on the other side of the sea saw that there was none other boat there, save the one wherein his disciples were entered, and that Jesus went not with his disciples into the boat, but that his disciples were alone, gone away alone." I found that to be really interesting, and of course, I'll not go into it because I could never finish it, but I want to give you the total picture. But can you see that? You see what I see there? the people that were there said, Lord, how did you get to Capernaum? You wasn't with them when they left. You didn't enter into the boat. You wasn't there. How did you get to the other side? That'd be interesting, Mark. Look at it and read it and enjoy it. The Lord does do things that just baffles people, that will just, people don't understand. Well, our time's gone. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word, and Lord, for the encouragement that we get from the word of God. And Lord, I just pray that your will be done. Every heart and every life in the morning service, Lord, that you'd just be with us, lead, guide, and direct us. For we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you're dismissed. Come be with us next week.